In order to feed the world's growing population, there's an increasing use of fertilisers to feed the already overused land, certainly overused in some parts of the world. We're talking now to Ed Marlow, who is the chief executive of a company that's operating in the Republic of Congo. The company is called African Potash, and it has an asset there which is not yet been drilled, but it is in the process of working towards that point, which we're going to find out more about it. Ed, it's good to talk to you.
Me too.
As I said, very important commodity.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of appetite for people wanting to get access and exposure to this.
Mm-hmm.
Your stock is a relatively small company.
Mm-hmm.
Explain a bit more about what it is you've got and mm-hmm. what the opportunities are for the investor.
Okay, if I go back in history, a couple of years ago, I was discussing a few things with one of my fellow directors, and we discussed an opportunity in Congo Brazzaville for potash, and at that time a company called Elemental Minerals had received a lot of press for an asset they were developing at the time, which was a high grade sylvanite deposit in a place called Sintakula in Congo Brazzaville. We believe that there's an opportunity to acquire a license there ourselves. I by background had had a lot of interest in fertilizer and African investments over a period of time anyway. And by the end of that sort of meal, we decided that we were going to look to create an investment company with a view possibly to try and pick up on the back of this sort of world demand for fertilizer, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And we created fairly rapidly a cash shell called African Potash, which hit the market in around about September of 2 years ago. And February of this year, we were able to finally acquire a license to explore for potash in Congo Brazzaville. So our company is now an exploration company in Congo Brazzaville, owning a license which is adjacent to that held by Elemental Minerals. Elemental Minerals, who have on their asset or on the resource itself a $2.8 billion NPV, who are currently the subject of a takeover bid, which is likely to proceed, as we understand it, by a group called Dingy, backed by the China African Development Corporation for $190 million. Elemental has spent a great deal of money in the ground. They have, my estimate would be around about $70 million, and they have proven an asset which is world-class, mm-hmm. Remarkable. Very shallow in depth, high grade, and very close to the sea, which is one of the great or the major advantages of the Congo Basin.
And your license is actually touching?
Our license touches on theirs, but is also interesting for other reasons, because
right.
while we would say some of our license areas would hold a very similar deposit in roughly the same place as Elemental's, which would be adjacent to theirs, we also think part of our southern, the part of our license area also has a similar deposit, will hold something very similar to that, but also is slightly closer to the coast and links in more easily to the infrastructure in Congo itself.
Which is why you want to go focus on that particular part.
Yeah, so our focus initially, I mean, and the other thing I ought to mention actually is we've just put on the board a gentleman called Dr. Simon Dorling, who is the CSA Global Principal Consultant, who did all of the work for Elemental in both putting together their drilling campaign and as a competent person, was the person who put together their resource. Mm-hmm. So he's come on board with us. We've also, as announced, signed a data sharing agreement with Elemental some time ago now, in which we not only have access to an enormous amount of data on the entire basin, which was originally put together by a group called Erkesplan from Germany, which includes pretty much everything from the old Hole potash mine. It also includes all of Elemental's data.
What interest has Elemental got in this then, giving you this data?
I think from our perspective, and indeed from Elemental's, at the time we agreed the data share, the spotlight needed to shine on Congo. People,
right.
perhaps for a variety of reasons, economy, et cetera, had sort of forgotten that this is really the place, the last remaining place where you have access to very, very high grade potash deposits, which are so close to surface and so close to the sea that in terms of export and in terms of cost of production, will be in the lowest quartile in the world. So Elemental wanted, If another player was actually looking at that market and exploring and was assisted to do that, that would help them in their own sort of, I suppose, ability to raise the big capital required to build a mine, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
And to stay independent?
And to stay independent.
Is that of interest to you?
Who knows? And
right.
Possibly. You never know.
But let's go back to your asset, because you don't know yet how good your asset is, do you? Because you have not actually undertaken drill.
We haven't put holes in, although within 500 metres of our area, we have actually drill logs for, you know, areas which
we
know.
We've acquired those.
We've acquired those, not just through elemental, but there's historical drilling which was done, 50s, 60s, 70s by the oil companies, which is when potash was first discovered in the Congo, before the whole potash mine was created, etc. So some of those historical drill holes easily extrapolate into our area. We also have seismic covering our entire area from the oil companies. And we also, because we have access to the data which was put together by Elemental, we also have, you know, we know exactly what they have, we can model from that. And Simon Dorling, who is our now non-executive director, who's focusing on the technical aspects of this, has access to all of the information he's created while he's actually been working for Elemental as well. So we're fairly comfortable that we have in our exploration area, and particularly in the southern part of our exploration area, something that will be very similar to the Sindikula deposit.
And you've got the money to do it?
We have the money to do the proof of concept, which is essentially what we need to do first, we believe. So we wouldn't call that full commercial drilling operation or exploration operation. So we have enough money to put in a couple of holes, 1,000 metres, and if we can get it in this year, partly because we have a rainy season that comes up in October, so things can have a habit of being delayed in the Congo, we hope not. We would expect to be able to get a couple of holes in which will demonstrate what we've got. And that, while we wouldn't necessarily want to produce a resource on the back of that, from what is actually there existing already would give us a pretty good indication of what we might have. Yeah. Secondary to that, obviously, the following summer we would be expecting to actually do probably a 12 to 14 hole drill program, which would give us the full resource statement which Elemental had when they actually had a market cap of around about $250 million and raised $50-odd million from the Canadian market around about a year and a half, 2 years ago. Yeah, 2 years ago, actually, now, as we speak.
So what do you say to investors or people looking at this? I mean, you're at a market cap of, what, just under £5 million?
I think do the simple maths. I think you look at Elemental, who have, the likelihood is they'll be bought at $190 million. I would expect the only thing that would derail that now would be someone else bidding for them at a higher bid. They've spent $70 or $80 million in the ground, I would expect, something like that. I mean, that's if you read their reports, if you look through their accounts, that's what you can see has been spent on exploration. And they've had a very, very good exploration program. If you knock that number off, you know, you've got a $120 million market cap, and we're sitting around about a $7 million. Yeah. We have the last remaining, I would say, good exploration license in the Republic of Congo. Nothing else is really available. You can go deeper, so you can go closer to the sea, and the stuff is much, much deeper. Likelihood of conversion from carnalite into sylvanite is low. And you are faced with, as we would find, I suppose, in our worst case scenario, building yourself a carnalite solution mine, which actually is the mine that's being envisaged going into production around about 2016, which is the old...
It's low quality, isn't it? Low quality.
It's lower grade. Yeah. It's lower grade. And the processing is more complicated, more expensive, so the cost of production is higher. But the quantity is there. So MAG Industries, which is now owned by the Chinese group Evergreen, who are the people who are building the 2-kilometre jetty at Point in Dien and are going into production and have committed funds and have paid for the engineering, etc., etc. MAG Industries will be producing carnalite, processing it in Congo before then shipping. So you need to process carnalite to get the higher grade, KCI, so it's a more expensive process.
Time's almost beaten us. We've got to wrap this, but briefly, where do you see the company in a year, two, 3 years' time? What's your long-term plan for Africa?
The expectation in 2 to 3 years, we'll have proven a resource. So we'll have a resource, and we'll be well on our way to... Certainly, we'll be at PFS stage. Whether or not we've actually got to BFS is, obviously depending on sort of timings and cash and all sorts of things. So
long-term plan... Long-term position and...
I think the simple thing is, again, do the maths on Elemental. Yeah, we're seeing around about a $7 million market cap. Discount all the money they've spent, they're $120 million. So I think long-term plan, there is real value in our company for investors. And long-term plan, I would expect to demonstrate that with our exploration program. We have a pretty fair certainty of success in that.
Okay, it's a pleasure, Ed. Thanks for joining us. Ed Muller, Chief Executive of African Potash.